Welcome and thank you for joining the webinar today. I'm Amanda Jadro, the Director of Portfolio Management at TRICOM. As an administrative and financial solutions provider to the staffing and consulting industry, it is our philosophy to be an active member of the staffing industry by staying abreast of the ever-changing marketplace. For that reason, TRICOM was pleased to launch the Industry Insider webinar series designed to share our expert knowledge and resources with our fellow staffing industry colleagues. One of our core values is to build relationships and become a leading resource to staffing and consulting firms nationwide. Our presenters today are Timothy Shuhai and Brian Curtis with Becker LLC. Tim is a member of the firm and chair of Business Services Group and co-chair of the staffing group. Under the firm's business services model, Tim counsels staffing industry clients with respect to growth strategies, succession planning, mergers and acquisitions, risk management and indemnity issues, operational issues, and the structure and content of MSA, VMS, and PEO agreements. Brian is a recognized authority in the areas of employment law and litigation, human resources management, and contract law, and serves as counsel to the Becker LLC. Brian is a highly skilled, action-oriented lawyer and business consultant with expansive experience in executive level and management employment matters, with an emphasis on the staffing, hospitality, and healthcare industries. Their staffing practice is national and one of the largest in the country. They have 9 attorneys that dedicate a material portion of their practice to the staffing industry. They counsel staffing firms on all of the major strategic and operational issues impacting their business. In this regard, they offer advice on structuring mergers and acquisitions, HR, regulatory compliance, onboarding, offboarding, compensation strategies and plans, client contracts focusing on indemnification and other key risk provisions and litigation. Their dedication to understanding the staffing industry delivers tangible benefits to their staffing industry clients. One way to attract and retain talent is by offering paid time off, or PTO. However, this employee benefit presents some unique challenges for staffing businesses. While it is not a federal requirement, many states and cities have enacted legislation that requires employers to provide varying amounts of PTO time with compliance for these regulations based upon what city and state the employee is working. In today's Industry Insider webinar session, Tim and Brian will cover the top policy considerations for paid time off, including state-specific regulations, policy period, paid time off category types, granted versus accrual systems, flat allotment versus a tiered PTO schedule, unused PTO time regulations, pending legislation. By the end of this session, you'll know how to develop the paid time off policies for your staffing business. If you have any questions during the presentation, please use either the Q&A or the chat feature. After the presentation, there will be time for any questions and an opportunity for you to give us your feedback on today's webinar by completing a short exit poll. With that, I will turn the floor over to Tim.
Thank you so much, Amanda. Welcome, everyone, to this afternoon's session. The format of the session will be Brian and I talking. I will be facilitating the discussion. Brian is a subject matter expert in this area, and I will try to have him share his knowledge on the area. We invite your questions either through the Q&A or the chat function on the webinar. Brian, are you there?
Yeah, I'm here. Let me
start by asking, Brian, what from a 50,000-foot view, what are the primary considerations in crafting a PTO policy?
Well, I mean, there's a number of different issues, but primarily let's start with making sure everyone has an understanding that, you know, there's generally two types of categories that fall into PTO policies, two types of categories of leave. Category one is like the family leave, disability leave. That's usually the type that is only taken occasionally. Most employees will use it just a few times, if at all. during their tenure with the company. Category two, it's the one that's more the focus of today's webinar, and that is the type that's granted by the company typically on an annual basis, with the expectation that most of the employees will use all the time provided over the course of the year. That's kind of what we're going to focus on today. Vacation time, sick time, personal time, all included in a PTO policy. I mean, a lot of what you want to make sure is in the policy, the things you have to view. We'll go over the top five policy considerations. One is whether the paid time off is granted versus accrued, what time period you should apply, whether there should be different allotments for different groups of employees, whether you want to use one PTO bank or a multiple PTO day type. These are the most important of the issues. And of course, more significant is, whether you can have carryover time from one year to the next for any unused time that your employees bank, so to speak. And then, of course, part of carryover would also be whether or not, as employers, you can cap the amount of time they're allowed to take. Okay? From a 50,000 view, that's what you need. Those are your top policy considerations at this point.
Well, is it fair to say between the two categories that category one, like family leave and disability, are really driven by statute or regulation, and that those are more compliance-driven, whereas category two, there's a little bit more discretion for the employer?
Yeah, absolutely. That's a great distinction to make for these, particularly in trying to look at, based on the circumstances of your employee's need for leave, which particular types of statutes would apply or regulations would apply. Like in New Jersey, you've got the FMLA, which is the Federal Law of Family Medical Leave Act, as well as the FLA, the Family Leave Act here in New Jersey, and then you have family leave, paid insurance leave, and then if it was the person needs time off instead of a family leave issue, it's a personal issue, whether it's a disability leave, well, is it a work-related disability leave, because then the workers' comp statute comes into play in any given state. The family leave and disability leave types of time off are definitely much more driven by the law and the regulations that apply to them. And generally, in most states, granting or putting a vacation leave policy into place is something that's within the discretion of the employer. Most states across the country do not require companies to provide these types of leave policies. There are exceptions under the paid leave ordinances that have popped up over the last few years, as well as which are requirements statutorily required. As far as vacation time, that's not something that typically is required by a state. But if the employer voluntarily decides to provide these types of benefits, well, then most states have a significant number of regulations that you have to follow as the employer in order to not violate those regulations and to be in compliance.
But today we're going to focus on more of the discretionary vacation sick time, though with an asterisk, because sick time may be covered by some of local rules, right? Regulations. Jumping into category two, is there two or three or four different ways to approach this issue when granting, like, vacation time, paid time off?
Yeah, I mean, the approach is primarily whether or not you want to – the first approach in looking into deciding this is whether or not you want to provide it as a grant or on an accrual basis. And you'll see, I think, on the PowerPoint, the attendees can see that, there's a provision here. You have the option to structure it so that the whole bank of days that in a given year can be granted on day one of the calendar year. Or alternatively, you can create a system where the days are accrued, again, generally speaking, either through the pay cycle or monthly throughout the year. Essentially, if you do it monthly and you're providing, the easiest way to do that, if you're going to provide 12 days of leave time and it's a bank, then you accrue one day per month right? So, and there's issues with both of them, whether or not the full grant is something that is an appropriate method or whether the accrual is a better method for you. And it obviously is fact sensitive. But if you wanted to, Tim, you want me to just go into explaining the difference between the two, the various approaches?
Yeah, Ryan, that would,
yep. Okay.
That would
okay,
be great.
Great
if we could go right into the detail between the two.
Okay, great. So under a granted type of policy, as I said, it's something that you get the full amount of leave time under the policy granted to the employee as of day one. And as you know, as we note here, you know, yes, that's the mathematically simpler process, but, you know, you do run into an issue if you're operating in a state and, you know, for staffing companies that might be headquartered in California, New York, New Jersey, Illinois, but may have, you know, end clients in various other states where your employees are placed. You have to be concerned about what the regulations are in all those various states where you've made your placements. And so you have to be aware of the fact that some states may require a payout of earned time off based upon or at the time of termination. And particularly in California, that's a requirement because California reviews earned vacation time as wages. And some other states many other states actually do view that as well. So probably a fairly good half and half type of mix of states that do allow, do provide that or require it. So if you're going to be on a grant basis and, you know, and you're on a calendar year and your PTO policy is such that all of your employees get their full bank for the year on January 1, and your employee quits on January 2, you got to pay them that time.
Well, and Brian, let me ask you this. Does that apply in your experience to all employees? So it's a policy that everybody gets a bank on January 1?
Well, that's a great point. There is, depending, again, on the state, many states will allow companies, and I think we cover that a little bit later on in this about having different allotments for different groups of employees. Many states do allow employers to restrict the provision of benefits to their full-time employees. Part-time staff may not be eligible for these types of benefits. So, yes, there is that consideration. Again, we're talking about, you know, if we view paid time off and all of the different types of benefits that would be provided therein, including vacation time, sick time, and personal time, understand that most of the sick leave ordinances that have developed over the course of the last few years do, and state regulations do provide that even part-time employees can accrue sick time, paid sick time, over the course of time because it's a matter of just how much time they work and the certain number of hours over the course of time. They automatically earn one banked hour of sick time. So although states might be able to restrict you on the vacation time as to whether or not you have to provide it to all employees or just your full-timers, the sick time allotment is something you'd have to, in most instances, have to provide to all your employees.
So is it correct that if I'm an employer and I have a granted policy that starts January 1, as we're using by example, that an employee could start with me January 1, be granted their 2 weeks vacation, I'll pick a number, and work for me for 2 weeks and quit, and I would have to pay them for their accrued vacation time because it was granted on January 1?
Actually, the interesting thing is that you've made the distinction there. It, under a grant-style policy, if it's granted as of day one, it doesn't matter. They could, if it's granted as of January 1st on a full calendar year, they could quit on January 2nd, and you as the employer in most states under a grant-style PTO policy would have to pay them. You're not using an accrual method. You're giving them a full grant. So they don't even have to work that time. They don't have to work that time in order to receive the benefit. They don't have to work 2 weeks to get 2 weeks' worth of PTO time if you're on a grant policy. That's what I mean. Mathematically, it might be simpler, but you run into this issue of having to pay employees for time out, for vacation time as a grant as opposed to an accrual. So the
let me ask you this under the grant model as well. Say that you hire the employee under the grant model, and it's not working out, and you want to terminate them, and assuming there's no problems with the termination, that you would still have to pay them the granted vacation time.
That's an interesting scenario. Great question. And it depends on what your policy is in that situation, on whether or not, you know, you may have that you can put a restriction on your policy that says that, you know, in certain instances, you forfeit your right to vacation time or to any fringe benefits. You forfeit your right to those if you're discharged for cause. So some, and many states allow that. Again, another caveat, though, is that California specifically does not provide for that. You cannot, again, force somebody to waive their what is considered earned vacation time. And in California, if you have a grant style or a grant model policy in which you give full benefits as of day one of the calendar year, then that's considered wages that are earned on that day. They don't have to continue working for you to accrue the time. Okay? So yeah, there is an issue where you, even in an employee who's not working out for you and you want to terminate, you may in some instances be required, depending on where you're operating, be required to pay them if you're using a grant model on your vacation, on your PTO policy.
So it's fair to say under the grant model you get some mathematical ease in calculation in granting these, but it creates these down-the-line issues or potential down-the-line issues of retained liability or exposure for the employer to, you know, to pay for vacation time depending on what happens to the employee.
Yeah, it's a greatly reduced. The grant model is popular primarily because it greatly reduces the administrative burden. The downside of it, or the risk to it, is, you know, your employees abusing it in some instances where it's like, okay. You know, but how often does that happen? How many of your employees do you anticipate would actually do that? So if you're looking to reduce your administrative burden and you have a fair number of if you have a manageable number of employees, it may make sense to use the grant model. As I said, you know, particularly with our clients, the popularity of the model is the reduced administrative burden on it. Because of the regulations that apply, particularly when you're using an accrual-based method. That applies, of course, in what state you're operating in as well, because, again, some states view this as wages. So if you're using the grant model, it doesn't matter. It's considered earned wages as of day one.
So using this as a foil compared to the accrued model, I'm assuming that the accrued model has more benefits that probably are the opposite of the grant model. And could you walk us through how the accrued model works?
Sure. I mean, the accrued model is good in this situation because it's something that's earned over time. The administrative burden is a lot greater, though, because you have to keep track of all of this time as it accrues, and you have to keep track of it in terms of whether it's going to be vacation time, sick time, or personal time, and we'll get into that later on. Where you'll remember before I mentioned about from the 50,000 foot view, that there's this issue, and the recent trend has been to have a PTO bank instead of having a multiple type day bank, where you have it separated out by vacation, sick, and personal. And we'll get into that a little bit later in this webinar because the popularity of that one single PTO bank is on the wane, so to speak, particularly because of the increase of paid sick leave requirements and ordinances over the last few years. But anyway, under the accrual policy, you have you have the time where, as I said before, the vacation time accrues as the person works. They earn it over the course of time. So again, And I'm just saying this for simplicity because I think most people will probably use either 5 days or 10 days for their PTO policy, but we're just going to use this as an example of 12 days, and it's a monthly accrual. So essentially your employee, your policy provides for your employees to accrue 1 day a month. That's fantastic. If you're on a calendar year, where the accrual starts on January 1st, that's great, but what happens when, you know, you'll notice here, and I think in the PowerPoint, we make mention of the fact that, you know, what happens when an employee wants to take a vacation in February for a week, and they've only got 2 days accrued? You know, obviously, without viewing, I'm trying to simplify this, so let's not look at the fact that they might have had some time carried over from the year before. That's an understanding. But say they used all their time from the year before, so there's no carryover either. In this scenario, you now have to be able to administratively manage the fact that they're going to borrow some time going forward. All right. So they want to take 5 days off for a vacation in February. They've only earned, let's say, vacation in March. They've only earned 2 days, one in January, one in February. So you're going to, as the employer, and most states would require this, would be considered reasonable under the regulations, you would, under an accrual process, you'd be required to advance them that time, okay, if you had that policy in place. And then once they came back to work, you could then deduct that time, that earned time, back for the next 3 months. What happens, though, if in that next 3 months, what happens if they come back and they quit the next day? So they never finished out the month of March, April, or May, all right? I'm sorry, when they come back in March. They never finished out the last 3 months. So essentially, you gave them three vacation days because whether this is in the vast majority of states in this instance, when I say vast majority, I'd say probably, I think, like 46 of the 50 states require that, do not allow employers to try to recoup that advanced vacation time out of the final pay. Most final pay regulations in most states do not allow employers to deduct negative balances that are in someone's PTO account, all right? So, yeah, so I mean, there is that risk as well.
Yeah, and to be honest, I, as a slight aside in the story, I had a client that had an accrued policy with no carryover. So it was use it or lose it in the year that it was accrued. And it took them a while to figure out that that doesn't work because your employees earn their last day of vacation on December 31st, then it evaporates because there's no carryover. So there is some mathematical issues with this, but really the big one for employers is that you could have this negative balance, that people all the time borrow against their accrued vacation.
Absolutely. You know, and so that's what I was saying. It becomes a much more administratively burdensome process, particularly because now that you have that in place, again, most states don't mandate PTO in terms of vacation, other than the sick leave ordinance issues that we have to deal with. Most states don't mandate it. But if the employer provides it as a fringe, then there's a number of regulations you have to follow to make sure you're compliant. And I tell you, you know, I've had this situation arise where, you know, it's always a business decision to make. If you're going to provide the fringe and then you're going to look at it and be like, okay, well, you know, we'll do what we need to do. We'll do the basic in order to manage this policy, but we're not really going to be particular about it. Over the last, I'd say, 4 to 6 years, and we haven't really seen a change even in the administration, in the change of the federal administration, there really hasn't been a change in the focus by the DOL in looking at these issues and imposing penalties. One thing I always tell our clients, Tim, I know you're aware of this, is, you know, you have to understand that these DOL inquiries and audits, they're self-funding groups. They're out there looking for these types of violations because, you know, that's part of what funds their ability to continue this process. It doesn't all come from tax income, as much as we'd like to say. It doesn't all come from tax revenue, in other words. So they are on the lookout and for these types of violations. And the penalties, again, over the last 4 to 6 years have really been, significant may not be the right word, but excessively increased. A lot of times what we've seen is penalties for these types of violations have doubled over the last 4 to 6 years. So what might have in the past been a $500 violation is now $1,000. The other issue, too, is what has been changed in how these violations are calculated. Oftentimes, they're calculated per employee, per pay period, or per earning period. So you have a violation where you have an accrual of one day a month, so your accrual rate is that essentially is an earning period of 1 month. DOL looks at this and over the course of the last year says, 20 of your employees each month over the last month were burned by your process, and now you've got 240 times $1,000. Because it's 20 employees over 12 months times $1,000 per employee per earning period violation. Now you're looking at a $240,000 violation in, for things that in the past might have been, in that situation, 20 employees over the course of the year might have run you about a $5,000 to $7,500 fine. It's kind of crazy. Now, our experience has also been that the DOL typically won't impose $250. They use it as a bargaining chip and negotiate down from that position, obviously, and typically are in the situations that we've dealt with in these audits for our clients where that's occurred. In that scenario, at 240, usually you'll come in around $25,000 for your penalties now. But think about the difference. That's still almost a five-fold difference, five-fold increase in what the penalties you may be confronted with. So it does pay, despite the fact that it's administratively burdensome, it really does kind of pay to keep abreast of this and pay attention to the details managing these types of policies.
And might I add one other thing that we experience too is clients, employers switching between the two. I've seen a lot of, and I'm sure Brian has too, companies that have traditionally been a granted model company that want to switch to the accrued. And just from the non-legal point of view, that, from a cultural point of view in the company, that we've seen that it's difficult because you're going from something that's fairly easy to understand from, especially from an employee level on the granted side, to something that's a little bit more difficult, nuanced, they have to keep track of it too. It's easy for everybody administratively, just not for the employer, but for the employee to understand the granted model versus the accrued. Because most employees, there are some that keep very good track of what their accrued vacation is, but most don't keep track of it on a daily or weekly or monthly or annual basis even then. So moving from a granted to accrued program, although beneficial in a lot of ways for the employer, can cause some, as we call them, soft issues, morale issues on the employee side, just because it's going from something that's easier to understand to something that's a little bit more burdensome.
Right. Tim, that's a great point. I'm glad you brought that up because the transition process in doing that, for anyone who's an attendee right now and is familiar with these processes, most states, vast majority of states, if you have a grant model right now and you want to transition to accrued, you have to make sure you can run out of compliance and be in violation, because most states have regulations that require that the transition cannot result in any type of negative impact on the employee. In other words, you can't force them to now lose whatever time they've accrued. You pretty much have to give them an option of either whatever has been granted from day one. If it's still outstanding, you typically have to tell them, like, either take it or we pay you out for it before you can actually transition, all right? Or you can have them, if you want to have a carryover component to your new accrual policy, you can have that all carry over. So it's kind of crucial to really think through the process because, again, other regulatory violations come into play separate and apart from the policy itself if you transition from one type of model to the other.
And now that we've looked at the kind of the difference between the two, I think we're going to focus more on the accrued and jump into the importance of time periods. And Brian, why don't you tell us, you know, kick us off with what's really important about these?
Yeah, I mean, the time periods, it's anniversary date versus calendar date. So mostly we've been focusing on the calendar date, where it's, you know, it doesn't really matter when the individual employee started at the company. You know, the calendar date is they're given a bank of time. Again, if it's, and we're going to focus on accrual, not grant. So on an anniversary date, it's an accrual method. Once they start working for you and they start on July 1st, then and as of August 1st, they've got one day. Again, if we're using that same model of 12 days a year, accruing over 12 months, right? And that's essentially how the accrual would work on an anniversary date going forward. The calendar date is really only important, and really the only distinction there has to do with if you're going to use a grant policy as opposed to an accrual policy. Is obviously you want to make sure that the employee understands that whatever is going to be provided to them in the form of PTO is on a pro rata basis upon their date of hire going forward through the end of the calendar year, all right? By choosing the anniversary year, meaning the person accrues as of July 1st through July 1st of the following year, there's really no need to prorate, at least not in the first year. And also it's important if you're going to tier the policy based on tenure, it makes it easier for the employee to understand where they fall within those tiers and what kind of PTO they've had accrued over the course of the time they're there. Again, this is an administrative burden, but you can, you know, use a paid time off tracking system. There is software out there that can assist you with maintaining this. Particularly, it's important to make sure you have it in place, again, in those states where you operate that have sick leave, paid sick leave ordinances and state regulations, all right? And the calendar year, you know, you base the policy on the calendar year. Everyone starts the same schedule, same amount of leave. But, again, what we said before is someone who starts mid-year can be a little bit tricky. And this is also an issue if you have a policy where, you know, you have a use it or lose it type of policy that's in place, because oftentimes you wind up with a situation where then at the end of the year you've got a lot of your employees scrambling to use all of their time so they don't lose it going over into the next year, since there's no carryover. And like I said on the PowerPoint, this can be a particularly difficult issue to manage if at the end of the year, the last 2 months of the year, you guys are, you know, you as an employer are running a business that's particularly busy in November and December. I think for most of us, December is just a busy month across the board if you're operating on a calendar year rather than a fiscal year. It's, you know, it's year end. There's a lot of stuff that needs to be wrapped up, a lot of invoices that you need to get out to get clients to pay you, all of those issues that are floating around out there for year-end, tax reporting and everything else is all something that I think makes it difficult to use this type of policy with a use-it-or-lose-it component to it. Now, one way to address that on use-it-or-lose-it is, you know, as an employer, you got to be willing to then, if it's use it or lose it and you don't use it, then here, I'm going to pay you out the time because it doesn't carry over, all right? That's one way to keep yourself compliant. The vast majority of states would allow an employer to have a use it or lose it policy with no carryover, provided they paid that time to the employee rather than forfeit the time, okay?
So what we've done now is kind of laid the groundwork. We're now into an accrued model. We've looked at what type of approach we're going to use, calendar year or otherwise, and now we're going to address, and I'd like to drill down on what, Brian, you talked about before, which was, you know, having different allotments for different types of employees.
Yeah, I mean, the two things we've got is you either have a tiered level of benefits or a flat level of benefits. Flat is pretty easy. It's like, do you want to have everybody gets the same level of benefits across the board? Everyone gets a bank of 10 days to use however they want to use it for the whole course of the year, no difference. Oftentimes, particularly in professional lines of business, you're probably better off using, particularly if you want to use fringe benefits as an enticement to attract and retain high-level talent, then obviously you want to have a tiered level of benefits that provides someone with greater experience. You can do it based on a tenure, and you can do it based on job title. Most states don't have restrictions to that effect. Most states do allow you to have these tiered style benefits. It's the issue of whether you want to use this as a measure of attracting and retaining, high-level talent for your company. So you may have a situation where, your administrative workers receive, 10 days, but your management workers receive 15. You have administrative workers who receive 5 days. Mid-level management receives 10, executive gets 15, something along those lines. It doesn't have to be double-tiered. It can be triple-tiered. Again, you can do it by way of tenure, so you've got an administrative level. You can have a hybrid version where it's tiered, just as I discussed, based on the level of that you're at, whether you're administrative, mid-management, or executive, but also throw into that mix a combination of, tenure. So you may have someone who's a mid-level manager who starts out brand new at 10 days, but you've got an administrative employee who's been with you for 20 years who your policy allows them to have 15 days at that point because they've been with you for so long. What does that sound like? It sounds like a pretty heavy administrative burden. Once again, can be handled, but typically you have to do it by way of some type of PTO tracking management software.
And Brian, these choices are discretionary for the employer.
Absolutely. Yeah. The issue being that these types of things are all discretionary, again, with the exception, I apologize for being repetitive, but with the exception of those states and cities that use sick leave ordinances and state statutes, most of these across the board are voluntary in nature, discretionary in nature. But once the employer acts to provide these benefits, then there are some mandatory issues that have to be addressed. Okay. Once you make the choice to provide the benefit, you then are subject to a number of different regulations that are, in fact, mandatory.
Is it fair to say that, once you enact these types of policies, they have to be enforced and utilized on a consistent and fair basis by the employer? I mean, I think that's probably the high-level way to look at it. Is that correct?
Yeah, I agree. Consistent, I think anybody who's on this call right now knows that in dealing with, and anyone who has any HR background knows that in dealing with these types of issues, consistency is always the best approach. I think that's the best approach to everything, but particularly in addressing these types of benefits to employees or any type of HR employee matter, it's important to be consistent in your approach across the board. Remember, though, the issue, and I think we put on the PowerPoint, one of the issues is a hidden issue, is whether or not these types of policies could essentially violate anti-discrimination laws. Many states at the federal level, as well as a number of states across the country, have anti-discrimination statutes that even if your policy is not discriminatory on its face, meaning the company is not intending to discriminate against somebody based on their age because they have a tenured-style tier policy. It has nothing to do with age. It has to do with the fact that, I understand that this guy is 50 years old, but he's been with our company for 30 years, and that's why he's getting as much time as he's getting when you are younger or you might even be older, but you've only been with us 5 years, and so you're getting less time than him. It's not an age discrimination claim. It's just based on tenure. But there are a number of states that have statutes, anti-discrimination statutes, that are based on what they call a different impact, or what the disparate impact, a discriminatory impact, meaning the employer is not intending to treat anybody differently, or by treating their employees differently in certain circumstances, they're not even discriminate. But the impact of them may be discriminatory in nature, and so you got to kind of be aware of balancing that issue as well, because it's a hidden issue that a lot of HR people and management people, particularly CFO people who are in the CFO vector in the business, because that's usually where HR falls within the context of operating the business, because you know payroll is the largest expense. And so the CFO is pretty much the top executive who's dealing with these issues and has an HR director who's assisting him or her with it. And oftentimes they're just not familiar with these potential pitfalls that are sitting out there, such as, you know, disparate impact issues regarding how you implement your PTO policy, right?
Right. So to sum it up, it's like you can choose, an employer can choose a tiered system, but you're looking at applying it fairly, revisiting it, like we've always said to our clients, you know, these aren't something you write, you know, seal in a bottle and throw in the ocean and never revisit again. These are things that you should look at, especially as your company changes in size and culture, and that could be growing and or getting smaller. So it does work on both sides of the change issue. And then, as you said, there are hidden issues to be aware of. We also have the idea of, as you mentioned, Brian, is PTO banks and different types of banks. Why don't you explain to the listeners the difference between those?
Sure. It's fairly straightforward. I think everybody understands one PTO bank means you're just putting all of the different types of time an employee may need to be off from work into one bank. So if someone is, you know, it doesn't have to be allotted to vacation time or to sick time or to personal time. You know, you just have one bank, and if you're going on vacation for 3 weeks, if you got 15 days in your PTO bank that can be used for any reason, and you want to take an extended vacation for 3 weeks, you can use that. Just don't get sick for the rest of the year because you have no time coming to you. That's how the one bank of a PTO bank works. And then you've got the multiple PTO day bank, and that is where employers will give you 5 days of vacation, 3 sick days, 2 personal days. So it's 10 days in total, but you know you have to put through your time. You know, if you go on vacation for a week, you have no other vacation time for the rest of the year. Which means you're going to be, you know, your employee's going to be calling in and coughing on the phone when they leave their voicemail saying that they're not feeling well, and that's their sick time. And remember that, you know, in those scenarios, you know, your policy on sick time, you know, you can't demand a note because of restrictions on disabling conditions and the fact that you're not entitled to have access to that information. A lot of states have regulations that say you can't require an employee to provide medical documentation for being out sick for one day. Most states require it to be at least 3 days that they're out. Some states do say 2 days, but there are no states that would allow an employer to demand a medical note from an employee who's out for one day. Not a state out of the 50 in the union that allow that, okay? Some do allow, a handful do allow it 2 days. Most don't allow, have regulations in place that restrict an employer from asking for a medical note unless the employee is out for 3 days in a row, all right? So understand that that's something that's an issue as far as using these when you have it allotted differently. Now, for the last few years, a lot of employers have been, again, for the ease of use of the single PTO bank, a lot of employers moved to that over the last few years. I'd say probably over the last decade, really, although maybe in the last five, starting about 5 years ago, there was a huge increase in the use of just singular PTO banks of time. Because the employer was like, well, you know, administratively, I don't have to worry about why they're taking the time, and I don't care. This is how much they're allowed to have for the year. This is what they can use. After that, they have no time, or they don't get paid for that time off if they have to have it, right? So it made sense because it really reduced the administrative burden. But over the last two or three years, with the high increase in states and municipalities and states implementing paid sick leave allowances based on how often someone works, they've kind of, I don't want to say gone by the wayside, it's not that, but a lot of companies will now be like, okay, here's your PTO, and we're going to carve out your paid sick leave time as a separate type of policy. Now, you may have a PTO policy in place that is already in line with what can be provided based on what's required under the ordinance or the state law. If you have that already in place, well, then you don't have to carve anything out, okay? Because you may just be like, look, I have a PTO bank of 15 days. This person, based on how much they work 40 hours. You know, they can't earn more than 5 hours a month based on the calculation for this, and it's within what the state law requires. Therefore, I don't have to now have a carve-out for a separate policy. You can still use your PTO bank, but it requires you to analyze that, what your current PTO policy is, and make sure that it's in compliance with every jurisdiction in which you're operating and where you've placed wherever your end clients are, and you've placed employees there. You would be required to ensure that that's in compliance with whatever the locality is or the state. And remember, for purposes of these types of requirements too, you know, a lot of times it would be like the ordinance or the regulation would be like it only applies to employers with 5 employees or 10 employees. How this time gets accrued, sick time gets accrued. Just because you placed 2 people in that state doesn't mean it. The way the regulation, most regulations work, most of the state regulations work, is it doesn't really matter. They look at you as the employer. How many employees do you have? If you've got 50 employees spaced out over 5 different states, then you're considered an employer that would be subject to, or what they call a covered employer or qualified employer, and subject to the statute or the regulation. Okay? Just keep that in mind, that even though you may only employ 2 or 3 employees in that particular, play with that particular client in that specific state, doesn't mean you're not still subject to it, because they look at your overall number of employees. Kind of similar to what they do with the Affordable Care Act requirements.
Right. So the takeaway here with the accrued is there's an additional administrative burden on the employer. There are benefits to doing it depending on which tiered system you pick. But that with paid sick leave in the multiple jurisdictions that are now having different laws about it, that it may treat paid sick leave as wages. So there's a more administrative burden that you have to, you know, manage as an employer based on the jurisdictions you're in. I think that's probably a fair statement, Brian. Am I correct?
Absolutely. And it's important to do it. I mean, a lot of people are like, well, you know what, we have the basics in place and that's good enough. But as I said before, the risk that you run in that situation is you know, the increase, the excessive increase in the number of the change in the formula of how the DOL looks at penalties and imposes them, and how they have been increased, you know, the per penalty increase over the last few years. It's become much more of, not only is it administratively burdensome, it becomes much more of a business risk to have to evaluate whether or not you want to continue just using basics or kind of have a more detailed approach to it.
And in the interest of time, I'd like to move forward to the idea of what to do with unused days, carryovers, caps, and payouts, because I think this is important and an area in my experience with clients that can be somewhat confusing. So, Brian, why don't you take us through this area?
Sure. You know, carryover, the taps, all, just about every state, even California allows for, and New York allows for caps on the amount of time that someone can, number one, someone can accrue, and allows for caps over time of what can be carried over to the next year, and even has restrictions or even allows companies to say, okay, I'm giving you 10 days a year, you can carry over. You can only carry over five. You have to use five. You can only carry over five of those days. And if you carry over those 5 days, you got to use them all by March 31st, by the end of the first quarter. Most states provide and allow for employers to impose those types of reasonable restrictions on carryover. The main issue with carryover is if you're going to have a use-it-or-lose-it policy, It's important to ensure that the employee understands and has been notified that they cannot carry it over. If it's a use it or lose it policy, if they don't carry it over or they can't carry it over, the employer is obligated in most instances to pay them out the time so that it can't be carried over. Specifically and particularly if, and this happens quite often, you know, you wind up a lot of employers particularly in retail and hospitality industries, have blackout periods at the end of the year, at the end of the calendar year. November and December have a blackout period. You can't take vacation. A lot of companies have them throughout the year. Might be a month here or 2 weeks there for whatever reasons. If you have those blackout periods and you particularly have them at the end of your year and you have a no carryover policy, you better be in the financial position to be able to pay that vacation time out to your employees. Because if you're going to prevent them from taking the time in the last 60 days of the year and have a policy that says you use it or lose it, if they don't use it by November 1st, you're going to have to pay them out. Because it's highly likely in just about every jurisdiction that you're going to have to pay a penalty if you don't pay the employee the vacation time, the unused portion of their vacation or PTO time. Okay?
All right, and let's move to caps quickly.
Yeah, I mean, like I said, here and there, in California, caps are not recognized. They don't recognize a use-it-or-lose-it policy because they're considered earned wages, kind of what we talked about before in the grant model. But you do, as I said, again, they can cap the amount of vacation time that someone can accrue at any given time. And it used to be a specific factor that California imposed, but I think about 2 years ago they changed it. There was a court decision that said it's not a specific factor. It's got to be what's reasonable. I think it used to be 1.75 was the cap that could be imposed, and now it's, for most parts, and certain decisions out of California do say, and in New York do say, that 1.5 would still be considered a reasonable cap. On how much they can accrue, right, and carry over.
Okay. And
you
that takes us to...
What happens oftentimes with carryover and caps, you see this a lot more often in public employment. You know, people who accumulate, they carry it over year after year, and they accumulate thousands of hours of sick time, and when they retire, you know, there's a $30,000 or $40,000 or $50,000 payment that has to be paid. So it's kind of important. And if you have a PTO policy that allows for unlimited carryover like that, you're going to run that same risk at some point, even in the past.
And that also takes us to the topic of payouts, too, that in the non-public sector, you know, there's something that, depending on the state law, Brian, is this something that employers want to consider on the payout side?
Yeah, I mean, there's a financial component to it, obviously. If you have a PTO policy that allows someone to accumulate without having carryover or caps on it, you run the risk of a lot of accumulation. And I can tell you right now, especially those, so, you know, somebody comes to you and says, you know, I noticed that just that Joe Z is, you know, he's been with us for 15 years and he's been getting 15 days vacation and he's only taken a handful of days the entire time he's here, and we're running a huge risk. And it's huge because of this. Most state regulations, if you're going to have this type of policy in place, again, vast majority of states, not just a few, but most, require you to pay out the vacation time at the rate of pay the person experienced at the time they want to cash it in. So he could turn around and say, under that circumstance, the end of 15 years, he's not even retiring. He's just like, I'm going on a cruise, Mediterranean cruise for 30 days, and I want to use 30 days. You got to pay him that 30 days as his rate of pay then. But when you record, you have to record out, and it's like a, for anyone with accounting background, it's a first in, first out. So when you record that time off and that deduction, you're recording his vacation time that was accrued as going back to the very beginning from 15 years before, and you have to calculate it back that way. That's important for your accountants here because ultimately the tax deduction for you guys is the value of what it was 15 years ago, even though your payout has to be made at the rate of pay he gets now. So it's really important to kind of look at these PTO policies and not let them carry over more than 2 years because it can become a really big financial burden if you let and believe me, there are plenty of clients that are still knocking on our door and calling us on the phone asking us these very questions about how do I do or how do I transition this or what am I supposed to do now that I got a guy who wants 60 days off and he's got 90 days in his bank that he's accumulated over the last 10 years or whatever. And, you know, we have to make sure that they calculate it correctly.
Well, and in the interest of time, in our PowerPoint, we've set out a compare and contrast between California and New York as an example of the different states' policies, but that's not to discount, that all other jurisdictions have policies, or many do. And in the interest of time, because we're creeping up on the hour, and I see that we have some questions, I think maybe we can, the California and New York are, Brian, if you want to give us a quick summary of them, and then we can get to some Q&A.
Sure. I mean, with California, as I said, like other states, it's no legal requirement to provide it, but the key in California is that once you have it in place, there's a whole slew of regulations that the DLSE, the Division of Labor Standards Enforcement, that's kind of like the DOL, part of the DOL out in California, will look at, particularly when it comes to vacation, because vacation component is considered earned wages. So in California, if you have a PTO bank, the way California reviews that, so if you have one bank, it's all considered vacation time, all right, because you're not separating it out. So in California, that's all considered earned wages that are accrued if you're using the accrual policy. If you don't separate it out, as far as California is concerned, all of it's earned wage and has to be paid to the employee. All right, that's the key piece that I think you need to know for California. For New York, holiday sick time for them, and vacation, it falls under time not worked. These types of policies, sick time, vacation time, personal leave, and holiday, is all something you can put in there. The big key in New York, from our view, is what you need to do for departing employees. Understand that you have to pay for whether you have to pay for unused time depends on what your policies are, in terms of vacation policy and/or resignation or termination policy. It goes back to what I kind of was talking about before, that if your policies are clear on how it gets paid out, someone who's terminated for cause you may not have to pay them under New York law if, in fact, you've clearly notified them of what the policy is and they have a clear understanding that they, if they're terminated for cause, they may not get any of their accrued time. Again, that's the exception to that is accrued sick leave because New York City does have a paid sick leave ordinance, right?
And I think it's clear that we could do a whole – several seminars on the differences in the different states' jurisdictional laws.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
But I think the moral of the story is that you really, can't say it enough. You really have to stay on top of these things, especially if you're an employer in multiple jurisdictions. Right, Brian?
Absolutely.
It's something we see daily. And right now, before we run out of time, we do have a couple questions that I will pose to you, Brian, that have come up. Let me see if I can find these, I think.
Tim, I can go ahead and read off a couple questions.
That'd be great.
Okay, so how about going from accrual for first year employee, then transitioning to granted beginning the second year of employment using an anniversary date?
Okay, that's, again, I would say that your biggest issue, going from accrual to grant would be appropriate. The issue that you have to be sure of, and actually I don't see that there's a negative to that, quite frankly, based on an anniversary date, because the accrual method would be their full year is done, and going to grant means that on their anniversary of their, on the first anniversary of their date of hire, they go to a grant, which means as of that date, they can then take whatever their bank is and use it the very next day or the very next week, however many days they have. So, and there's no, in that transition, there would be no negative impact on the employee. They're not required to give anything up unless your policy restricts them from carrying over, because that can still be an issue. So as long as you allow the employee to go from an accrual in their first year to a grant on their anniversary date, you got to let them carry over their time. If you're going to restrict their time, meaning no carryover, you got to pay them out whatever they've earned and unused on the accrual period, and then you can still go grant. But all those other things being considered, going from an accrual to a grant on an anniversary date doesn't have a negative impact on the employee, so you wouldn't run afoul of any of the regulations unless you had a no carryover policy and you refused to pay out that time that was accrued and not used.
Okay. Do you have any software examples? People are having a hard time finding a software that works for them in managing the accrual or even granted system.
Yeah, you know what, we can get back to you on that one. Tim and I would have to check. We do have, we are an industry partner, like Tricom is, with the staffing industry, and we do have a lot of contacts and relationships with companies, and I'm pretty sure we have some contacts that can give that information, but if you send your information to, or your contact information to either Tim or I, we can make sure to get a response to you on that. Okay.
Yeah, and in my experience, and thank you, Brent, I agree with that. There's a lot of choices, and they run the gamut from out-of-the-box add-on modules to, basic HR systems, or there's some that that provide applicant tracking systems that have these modules. And a lot of staffing companies have created their own proprietary software for dealing with this. With that said, there's a whole line of people that we work with in an incubated setting that are disruptive software people and the AI side and all that, that are doing a lot on this side as well. So send along your contact information and we can address it offline, probably a much better ability to do it that way.
Okay. Another question that's come in is you talked about the tiered PTO and the different category types. Could you have a separate category for internal employees versus temporary employees?
Yes, you could. There's no restriction on that. I see that often with, again, what you have to make sure of is it doesn't result in a discriminatory impact. In other words, the benefits don't accrue to a greater degree to your internals than they do to your temps. And you can talk to your HR people about whether or not there's a discriminatory impact as a result of that, whether it's based on any of the protected characteristics like age, race, or gender. They're the primary ones. But if you have a fairly diverse, fairly diverse pool of employees, both internally and temp, you're much less likely to have to worry about that issue. So, yes, you can have that. That's an additional component that you can put into your tiered benefits platform. So, again, Yes, for those two types of employees, yes, just like it would be different for administrative, management, and executive level, and for tenure lengths of service.
Okay, great. One of the participants mentioned that they use Built for Teams as a software tracking system, so that may be another option for someone who is looking at that. An additional question that's come in a staffing situation, client hired a temporary employee. Can PTO time earned through the staffing company be transferred with the employee to the client company to be used through them?
Well, I said no right away, but I should hedge my bet on that one. If the employee was a W-2 employee of the staffing firm that the end client then hired, and that person became an employee of the with no joint employer issue or co-employment issue, and they became an employee of the end client, then no, that wouldn't carry over. They don't get that time. Well, I shouldn't say that. They're not required to. The end client could make that award in the hiring, but the law does not allow for that to happen unless you're in a jurisdiction that provides for co-employment. And somewhere like California, if you're under a co-employment scenario where, you know, it's not a temp agency but a PEO with a co-employment issue, there may be where there would be carryover, right? I'm sorry, where it could transition over or transfer over to the end client as the new employer. Does it make sense?
Okay. For a staffing company that services multiple states, would you recommend setting your PTO policies at the same level in which the strictest rules apply and keep it consistent across all employees then?
Yeah, I mean, I think that's a good approach, again, obviously because of consistency and the use of that term. I do think that's a good approach that, but I think when in terms of strictest, the way I would characterize it is you want a policy that is the least restrictive against the employee and use that across the board, because that the way the regulations are, it's the issue is whether or not the employee is negatively impacted in some way by what the employer's policy is, right? That's what they'll look at. So just to make sure that we're on the same page as far as what they were saying about the strictest policy, it should be the view should be, if you want consistency in the approach for multiple states, you want to use the least restrictive approach as it pertains to the employee.
Okay, thank you. I know that people have a lot of questions on this topic, and since we are getting to the end of the session here and a little bit over, if anyone has any additional questions that they'd like to take offline, please feel free to reach out to myself, or you can reach out directly to Brian and Tim, and they'd be happy to address your questions and help you further. Did you guys have any final thoughts that you wanted to share with the attendees today before we wrap things up?
Tim, go ahead.
Thank you for your time. And again, these are fluid issues that impact, you know, your client, your employees, the morale of your employees, but are driven in large part by decisions that you make that are guided by the statutes and regulations where you're doing business. It's complicated, it's multi-tiered, multifaceted, and multiple variables, and it's something that you have to manage, if not on a weekly basis, some people on a daily basis, but it's something that needs a constant attention and care so that all those variables are addressed.
Ditto.
Wonderful. Go ahead, Brian.
No, I just said ditto. I agree with
ditto.
Tim.
Wonderful. Okay. Well, again, I put the contact information up on the screen. I want to thank everyone for joining us today, and thank you, Brian and Tim, for your time and all the expert knowledge that you have on the topic. If you have any further questions, please reach out to us directly. After the presentation, we will be putting a recording of the webinar on our website at tricom.com underneath the Resources Industry Insider webinar tabs. And there you'll see a library of our past sessions if you'd like to revisit any of them. Thank you again for your time, and watch for information on our next webinar session. Take care. Thanks, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you.